Hello, ladies and gentlemen, it's your favorite finance and accounting trainer, Alex Petrescu, here on my YouTube channel. I welcome today to my new video. We are going to have a little bit of changes today here with the structure of my videos. Namely, I will not present you another course today. I'm not done with my courses, so I have launched already since May 12 courses, roughly 4 per month. They are all to be found on Udemy and Patreon. Just a short wrap up. I have started with the finance for non-finance course, then I went through Excel, basic Excel course, then an advanced one. Then there were two courses which were focusing on tools, let's say, that are not really, or at least one of them is not 100% finance and accounting specialist oriented. That was the balanced scorecard, which only contains 25% KPIs, so financial KPIs. Then it was the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats, so the SWOT analysis, which is actually a management analysis, has not that much to do with the core finance and accounting competencies. And then we have started talking about, let's say, topics that are really within the profession very important for the performance management, at least. We have talked about KPIs, so key performance indicators in a company. We have talked about variable and fixed costs, or direct and indirect costs. Building from that, we have we went into the direction of talking about gross contribution or sales contribution, and also about the gross profit, namely how do you split the cost in direct and indirect, or in fixed and variable. You will get to one of these intermediary profit layers. Then we have also talked about credits and investments, specific to a company, of course. So on YouTube here you can find a lot of investment, let's say, advices for private individuals. And after talking about credits and investments, of course, the next step was to talk about the business cases, because they are somehow related. It's the difference between them is what kind of format you are using, and when to use one and when to use the other one. So for investments, usually it's recommended to use a cash flow format. For the normal business cases, when you have nothing to compare, and the capital expenditure, so the investment actually is not that large, you can use a P&L format. And then towards the end, we have talked about the cash flow. Cash flow is the third financial statement after the balance sheet, the P&L, and it's somehow not really used at its true power in performance management from various reasons. Okay, the knowledge about the cash flow might not be at the highest level within the profession. It's very difficult to introduce another financial statement to the managers. They are not used to it, and somehow it's being ignored, but it's very important, and it has its merits, and it's very important also to know when to use it. And the first course on cash flow was focusing on building a cash flow, so the basic knowledge and how to use the past results. And the second one was focusing on forecasting, so on budgeting, on forward looking into the future. How will your cash position look after a certain period? Of course, these are already 12 courses. Now I'm at in the stage when I'm just doing improvements to them. Just as I have said, on Udemy, on Patreon, for example, on Udemy, the captions will be available in short time. I have already done it for one of the course. Captions are like subtitles, so in case you don't understand what I'm saying, you can read it. So it's better. It's helping the students. Also improvement in terms of how have I clipped the chapters and organized the course and things like this, course image. And but let's say that before, the 99% important information was already there. Now I'm doing the, let's say, the 1%, which is making things look nice and improving things, but it's not really that much added value, and it's also a little bit of time consuming for me, because you can imagine everything that I'm saying needs to be written. I get a suggestion from the site, or well, maybe they are guessing what I have said there, but most of the times it doesn't really match what I have said and I have to correct them. In my mind right now, there are three other courses. One which is like 50% already done is the dashboard. The idea of having a snapshot, a slide, a pager, and showing the image of a company within one page so that everybody understands from various fields and external, internal managers, non-managers, and so on and so forth, understands what is the situation with the, let's say, with the company. And how to build it, and it's a very nice course. I think it will be very, very helpful for many. So it's like an executive summary. And then there are other two things which I have in my mind. One is the digitalization. It will be a lot of work behind it, because let's say a lot of, from my past experience, a lot of what I have to say in that course is wishful thinking. It doesn't exist yet, and probably it will not exist for a long, long time. As I'm imagining it, at least for the finance and accounting, but for the entire management information system in a company, it will not exist for a long time as well, because there is a very large discrepancy. On one side, you have in the business people that know business, but they don't know IT. On the other hand, you have the companies, external or the internal departments of IT, that know IT, but they have no idea how a company works. And bringing these two guys or these two groups of people together and really coming up with something which is very, very valuable is very difficult to happen. And another one was about the revenue segmentation and how you can look at your revenues, because it's revenues are a very a topic which is very loved by business people. And but with these two I haven't started yet, and probably they will come in the future. Also, as a quite a project that will start now in August, is that I will expand on another platform, or this is the Planet List, on LearnFly. I have been approached by them, and they want to have my courses on that platform as well. I have to remove all the barriers which are staying in front of using my courses on multiple platforms, namely the exclusivity rights and things like this. And yeah, so these are mainly the what I need to do with my courses, and a lot in the next period, of course, there will be a lot of promoting activities. So I will try to put links all over the place to let people know that the channel exists, that the courses are available, what they are offering, and things like this. That being said, we start directly with what used to be our second topic for the presentation. We are going to have a Tesla update on Q2 2021. So the results for the company Tesla are out there for the quarter ending June 2021. And first of all, I need to have a mea culpa, so I need to excuse myself. That's what happens if you just take a press article and you don't really look into the numbers yourself. I have done a mistake. The mistake is not that huge, because the numbers with this company are not that huge, so you cannot have a large mistake no matter what you do. Okay, I said in the last presentation that it had a revenue for quarter 1 2021 of 10.5 billions, and I knew the net income amount, which was 438 millions, but I didn't know the details. I knew the Bitcoin brought a gain of 101 millions. I knew that they made from CO2 certificates 518 millions. And of course, I have deducted as a difference for car manufacturing 181 million loss. Truth be told, this net income was a net income after, so it was attributable to common shareholders and after tax, while the Bitcoin gains and the CO2 certificates were before tax. So in no way these numbers were comparable. Also, the car manufacturing means actually all the energy generation and storage and services and others. So there are multiple business lines which are including in this car manufacturing. So I have corrected that. I'm no longer calling it car manufacturing. I'm calling the activity manufacturing. There is a slight correction also in the revenue levels from 10.5 billions to the 10.4, but the actual net income before tax, so and before minority interest and so on and so forth, was 533 million. Hence, the manufacturing activity, which includes all the activities as I have said, I have brought a loss of only 86 million. So I made the mistake of 100 million. It can happen. However, it's not distorting the overall image. In accounting, we have this principle of materiality. Yes, the number is large, but it's not the analysis and the ideas. The key ideas are staying the same, no matter if it's 181 million loss or 86 million loss. For the second quarter, the results were, let's say, better, not fabulous. And I will explain why not fabulous. They went to 12 billions in revenue. The net income reached 1.3 billions almost. They had a revaluation on Bitcoin, which brought them a 23 million loss. They only got 354 million from CO2 certificates, and the manufacturing activity, so the base activity, brought them 962 million profit. To me, these results are too good to be true. I'm just going to say it fairly and honestly. They are not audited, they are not final year results. We will see how things develop further. There is an improvement. What strikes me is that there is an improvement across the board. So, despite everybody knowing that in the pandemic we had the problems with the logistics, the semiconductors are not, so the chips are for the electronics parts and so on are not available and so on and so forth. The profit margins on cars increased from 26.49 in quarter one to 28.14 quarter two. I guess despite the problems, which I have already named, because they have increased, they went through multiple rounds of at the beginning of the year, they have reduced the prices, then they went through multiple rounds of readjusting the prices and basically increases for Model 3 and Model Y. Why am I saying that this is an improvement across the board? The OPEX improved with 49 million, so the operating expenses. The other expenses also improved with 42 million. And there are improvements in the gross profit of energy and storing business of 121 million, and even services and others has a 34 million improvement. Why am I saying that there is clearly an improvement displayed, but for me it's not spectacular because the it's still the if you take the largest car manufacturer Toyota, the company is still three times the company Tesla is three times more worth than Toyota, having 900, while Toyota has 900 times more revenue and 3,000 times more profit. So it's still, let's say, it's a positive image that you have this increase, but it's still somehow disconnected, and I will show you also further why and what happened. Then you have this nice visual representation, so this graphic representation of how the quarter profit changed, so the quarter net income. We went from 533 in quarter one, then the auto business brought 514. Net so gross profit increase, which is also contributing to net income. Here you have the CO2 certificates, the 300 millions that we already mentioned, so the 354 millions. Then you have the energy, which brought extra 121 millions, the services, which brought extra 34 millions, and then you have the improvements in operating expenses. 49 millions and 42 millions in other expenses, up to a total of 1 million, so 1 billion 293 millions net income in the second quarter. The loss on Bitcoin, the 23 millions, yes, it's included in this operating expenses, so in the 49 million increase actually. on total. Now with the Bitcoin, it's here is there are some considerations. It seems that there was a discussion in the accounting profession how they should be treated. Bitcoins in accounting, so they should be treated as cash and cash equivalents. They should be treated as inventory, as intangible assets, and they seem to meet the definition from the IFRS standards. Just one word of warning: Tesla is in US, so it operates under US GAAP. But under IFRS, it seems that the cryptocurrencies, or most of them, are meeting in the best possible way the intangible assets definition. So they should be governed by IAS 38 intangible assets. In this case, Tesla is using also, or it's using something which is similar to IFRS 13 fair value measurement. Then I have calculated, because I wanted to know how many bitcoins they have. It's a rounded value because they have 1.3 billions on the balance sheet at the end of quarter two, divided by the price of a bitcoin, which was at the end of the quarter two, so on 30th of June, was $35,969 per bitcoin. They have roughly 36,448 bitcoins, which this position is visible in the balance sheet as digital assets, and as I have said, it's an intangible asset. Then the cost of the acquisition can be derived, because since they've lost 23,000 divided by the number of bitcoins held, and by adding the value at the end of quarter two, you actually see that the price of the bitcoins, the average price of bitcoins they have bought, was $36,600. What they have now, they have posted at the end of Q2 revaluation increase. At the end of Q1, the 101 million was a gain on sale, actually. It's an explanation here, is an article, a technical article from ACCA. They couldn't have posted the revaluation gain at the end of quarter one, when the Bitcoin was actually 58,731, so from 36,600 to 58,731. Because they didn't post a loss before, and there is a very complex discussion about here. You have all the details, whether it should be recognized in P&L or in other comprehensive income, and against recognized losses or gains which were here before or not, and so on and so forth. Then I have calculated the Altman Z-score. Altman Z-score is a prediction tool. It's used to show if the company is in distress. Okay, there are five factors here, which everyone has a weight. So we have 1.2 weighted the working capital against total assets. We have 1.4 plus 1.4 weighted the retained earnings against total assets. Then you have the earnings before interest and tax against total assets, weighted with 3.3, 0.6 market value of equity against total liabilities, and here we will have an interesting discussion at market value of equity, and with one factor one, the sales against total assets. If this Z score is more than 3, so 3 or more, the company is considered to be in the safe zone. If it's between 1.81 and 2.99, the company is considered to be in a gray zone, so the things are already shaky. And under 181, so a value of 180, the company is considered to be in a distress zone. Then, of course, I took from the balance sheet the values. You have here on this slide more details. The value of, so for working capital, the value of receivables and inventory minus the value of payables divided by total assets. Then for the retained earnings, I have found the information that they have minus 3.6 billion retained earnings, or returned loss actually, also divided by the total assets. Then the earnings before interest and tax. The earnings before interest and tax I have calculated, I'm saying here, it's are the earnings of quarter one plus three times the earnings of quarter two, because basically you need to somehow forecast the earnings for the entire year. And that's this 4 billion 530. Then jumping directly to the sales and assets, sales also quarter one plus three times quarter two. And the only thing which I have changed, because this is the problem with this company, actually, that it has a market value which is astronomical, and from my point of view, with no reason at all, other that the investors jumped on buying this stock, and I don't think, I still don't understand why, but that's another problem. It has a price earning ratio, which is let's say the relation between the price of a share and the earning per share, currently 230. I looked at Toyota and the best result that it ever had, and so on, and I said, like, for the auto industry it should actually be 12, and that means that I have reduced, so I took 12 divided by 230, and I have reduced the market value of the company, which is 680 billions right now, which is crazy. And I have reduced it to a value which is around 35 billions, if I'm not wrong, which should be the value of such a company, of with these sales, with this asset base, with these earnings, and so on and so forth. And when I have computed this Z score, I got one. That's absolutely no surprise for me. I got 174. So the company should be in a very serious distress area. However, because of this unexplainable optimism of shareholders, if you take the actual market capitalization, so the 680 billion, you get to a Z score which is 15.12, which is taking it in a very safe zone. That means that based only on the fact that the shareholders are and were so enthusiastic, it means that the company can continue to finance itself. They can do secondary purchase offers, they can issue new shares, and so on and so forth, and they will get so much money, and they can continue to finance this, let's say, this madness for the foreseeable future. And that's why I'm saying, if the company should be in distress zone, if it weren't for the shareholders' blind trust. That's why I have adjusted first the market value of the equity, because I don't believe it's normal what's going on with this company. Then here you have all the links and explaining where did I got some of the, because some of the information that I got here is not included in the regular, so the accumulated retained earnings are not included in the financial statements. The price earning ratio, you need to for other car manufacturer, for car manufacturing industry, and so on and so forth, you need to look in other directions. That would be it with Tesla. How can you support me? If you like this video, please hit the like button. If you have something to add, please comment. If you want to contradict me, if you have a different perspective, I would be glad to have a conversation with you. If you think somebody else would be interested about this video, please share it. And most important, if you like this video, please press the subscribe button. That's also really, really helpful for me. Also, there are some other ways through which you can help me. Since we have talked already about investments and various opportunities of investing in these videos that I'm presenting, you have a link to eToro through which you can create for yourself an account and trade without commission or a fee. Even if you are a long-term investor and you are not doing that many trades, it will help you save some money. If you are trading very often, avoiding these commissions and fee will be very beneficial, unless you are very, very rich and the commissions don't mean anything for you. Then there are two links from the Amazon. One is you can get two free Audibles. If you like audiobooks, you can click the link. Also, there is the Kindle, so a link for the Kindle program. I also have a Kindle, and I like electronic books because you can carry more books with you. It's easier. Many people are fans of classical books, of feeling the weight of the paper, and the smell and things like this, but since a few years ago I'm very much fan of these electronic books because you can store a lot of books on this device. It's very practical, you can carry it with you all over the place. It's very light, so it's not a heavy device, and so on and so forth. And last but not least, let's say the option which is most inconvenient for you, but it's still helping me with improving the quality of my videos. As you can see, we have a mix of natural and artificial light right now because there is raining outside. And with this wish list from the Amazon, you can help me acquire some items which will help me improve the quality of my videos, a better webcam, a light system, a green screen, maybe we can do these videos more dynamic, some software, the latest edition of Microsoft Office, better video editing software, a solution for filming videos while I'm away, so for traveling, namely a laptop, and so on and so forth. If you are so kind and you want to and you wish to help me, you can help me via this way. Also, all the other ones, especially the pressing the subscribe button, are, let's say, easier for you from many points of view. Should you choose to help me in your way, please do it. And once again, thank you very much.